Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. Jesus here, we'll see now in verse 21, refers to as great tribulation. For then there will be great tribulation, such as not been since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. I personally believe in the record of Genesis that this whole earth was covered with water at one point. And that in fact our God, in His omniscience, His all-knowing capacity, saved eight people, eight righteous people from all the earth as He closed the door on the ark and sealed it with His hand. And those eight people then, of course, repopulated this earth. Well, I believe that personally, but I also believe that Jesus is describing for us that the events that are going to soon succeed our time and the flood in those days, in Noah's days, will be horrifying, even worse than that. To the point that, of course, when the flood came, we know all everything that lives under the water was basically unaffected, right? Everything above that lives on the land was killed. But you see, in the days of this tribulation, He says that, in fact, all flesh stands at the point, at the precipice of being destroyed on this earth. But God's not going to allow that. God has an agenda that, interestingly enough, we're trying to understand. And certainly, in my lifetime, I would have never thought the Berlin Wall would come down. I would have never thought that in Daniel chapter 2 there would be a confederacy of European nations that would conspire, as it were, eventually in Scripture to dominate this world with one particular religious, economic, and political ruler who will somehow take the reins of this confederacy of European nations and dominate everything in this world to the eventuality of declaring himself at the midpoint of the tribulation as being God himself, forcing all humanity in those days to take a mark of allegiance, of worship of Him as being the Almighty God. Now, I think there's a lot of things happening today that are kind of leading us to accepting something so absurd, certainly within our minds as Christians and studiers of God's Word. I think, really, Hollywood is doing their best to rewrite the Scriptures, to kind of set a balance point with respect to what the Bible says really is just myths, as fables, as ideas that can be allegorically or spiritually understood, but certainly should never be taken as literal. There may have been local floods. There may have been certain floodings of the Euphrates, but certainly no worldwide flood. Just a couple weeks ago, Lucy and I were driving back from Los Angeles and going through the San Fernando Valley. You can see the strata of the mountains jutting right up into the air. You go by mountains where it seems as though the layers that once were sedimentary or something that was horizontal now is directly vertical. And any of you who've been to Yosemite, Any of you have been to Yellowstone and you've seen not only the geysers out of the ground, but seen the rock formations and stuff. And I don't know about you, but I wonder, Lord, what was that event that was so tremendous that the ground jutted straight into the air? Lucy and I have been to Nepal several times to visit the trust home of Tibetan refugee children that we support as a church. And it's an awesome place. It's in the eastern part of Nepal. And it seems as though there's no foothills there. It just goes from ground to straight up. And those mountains are phenomenal. I mean, it's just like, whoa, this is... But how do these things come about? The hand of God has formed this earth for His pleasure. And there's a valley or there's a mountain because God had determined in His omniscience, in His all-knowing, I want a valley there, I want a mountain here. And I suppose it's for some cause and effect in the sense that you and I would look at these mountains, look at these hills or these valleys or these, you know, if you've ever been to Switzerland and looked down the Interlaken Valley with the Alps on either side, you wonder whether you're actually looking in something that's real. It's that beautiful. But God had determined and designed, in fact, very artfully created these things, perhaps for the sake of us standing and looking in awe and wonder at the hand of God who would do such things at some time we're not familiar with it, doesn't seem to be apparent in human history that these things happened, that God formed the earth to the degree that He has. I don't know, but I know that God is going to be doing something that Jesus qualifies here as a great tribulation. The Greek word there is something you're probably familiar with. It's mega. So it's, you know, mega sale or colossal or, you know, that's kind of the thing. He's taking the 7 years of tribulation. He's saying, listen, the last 42 months, the last 3.5 years are going to be mega. Now, not as though the first 3.5 years aren't significant, because if we're connecting the dots of Revelation chapter 6 with this first 6 seals that are broken by Jesus and them each revealing some catastrophe on the earth or the introduction of a figure or an event or catastrophe, we certainly wouldn't think that the first 3.5 years was a picnic in the park. But the last 3.5 years seems as though there are events and occurrences that begin with an earthquake that Scripture describes in the revelation of John, of Jesus in Revelation chapter 6, that is so phenomenal that islands will disappear. The islands off Santa Barbara drop into the ocean. Mountains will be flattened. It's those kind of events that I look at mountains today and I think, what was it like then? How did the earth shake? But God, You had a plan. He still has a plan as well. And even though a period of mega trouble is coming on this earth, listen, He has a beginning to that and He has a definite end. And glorious as it is, the birth pangs that come to its peak, its crescendo, ends up being the introduction of the Lord of all glory down upon this earth, and you and I will be coming with Him. You and I as the saints of God will be coming with Him, whether you believe in a pre-tribulational or a mid-tribulational or a post-tribulational rapture. Listen, we all three groups agree that we're descending with Jesus from heaven and are going to occupy this earth, incorruptible and immortal, to reign with Him for 1,000 years. And those 1,000 years, Jesus will be bodily in the flesh, on a throne in the city of Jerusalem, and all the world will come and worship Him. Every tongue, every knee. And friends, you and I will witness these things, and I suspect it will be much like standing over the valley of Interlaken or looking at the Himalayas and thinking, oh, how can this be? How is it that I... There He is. We just sang, the lover of our souls. And He'll look at you and think of this. He knows you so intimately. He has watched every day of your life from the moment you were conceived in your mother's womb. As He breathed life into you, and knew the number of your days yet before one of them. His thoughts, as David says, were too high to attain. They're too glorious. They outnumber the sands of the sea, the stars of the heavens. God, our Savior, will look upon you. You're standing in front of him in an incorruptible body, in an immortal body, reigning with him. And you will look at your Savior, and he will speak to you personally and intimately. And perhaps rehearse and witness, glorify his name in the sense of how amazing truly his grace has been, how enduring, everlasting, truly his mercy has been. And I suspect the things that I will say to Jesus can only be said to an incorruptible heart, can only be said in such intimacy of connection with him that I know, Jesus, now I see you were with me every single hour. There wasn't a moment that I was away from you. You rehearse, even as I remember those events when I thought, Lord, I'm by myself and no one is with me, but you were there because you saw me and you think of me as I never thought you would. Jesus says, those days will be shortened. I'll bring them to an end because I know that all flesh cannot be extinguished. And I know also that I have a plan for those who've given their hearts to me as their Savior. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 30 tells us that God had a plan clear back when Moses was writing Scripture. Verse 31 says, he will not forsake you, nor destroy you, nor forget the covenant of your fathers that he swore to them. God's covenant to you is this: I will never leave you nor forsake you. Did you know Jesus is saying to you personally, I will never leave you nor forsake you? God is not going to break that promise. Our Savior is not going to break that promise. And he encourages us in the midst of our trouble in this life with the presence of his Holy Spirit that comes along our side and comforts, encourages, edifies us, exhorts us to look to his word, look to his throne, and run boldly in our time of need. That's the access. That's a privilege we have as Christians, friends. What a joy that is. Daniel chapter 12, verse 1 says, and the great prince who stands over the sons of your people, there's coming a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. Seems as though Daniel wrote a script that Jesus is following in Matthew 24. Even to that time, and look what he says, and at that time your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book. Thank you for that promise, Jesus. I don't have to be concerned. Zechariah 14, what a clear chapter predicting the exact return of Jesus to the city of Jerusalem. But Zechariah also says, and this is interesting to me, verse 2, for I will gather all the nations to battle against Jerusalem. The city shall be taken. Now that's interesting because when God says all, that typically means all, doesn't it? And you know what? That includes the United States. And in fact, Zechariah says they're going to come against the city, rifle the houses, rape the women. The city will go down in captivity. Remnant of the people shall not be cut off from the city. Thank you, Lord. Then the Lord will go forth and fight against those nations as he fights in the day of battle. Can you imagine what a war would be like between Jesus, even if he stood by himself, against Jesus and all the nations of the world? Bring every weapon that you own, every nuclear device you own, and just come against Jesus. Just come against Jesus. Who do you think's going to win? The Almighty God who created this universe? Or prideful man that thinks, look what I've created. I am a God myself. Thank you, Shirley MacLaine and Oprah Winfrey. And we can conduct ourselves no matter how we want to, as long as you don't judge us. We'll be tolerant with you as long as you're tolerant with us. Well, the battle is going to be a big one, and I've read the end of the book. I know who's going to win. How about you? Amen. The day is coming, Malachi says in chapter 4, verse 1, burning like an oven, and all the proud, yes, all who do wickedly will be stubble, and the day which is coming shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts. that will leave them neither root nor branch. But to you who fear my name, are you listening? This day, to you who fear the name of the living God, this is God's promise for you, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings, and you shall go out and grow fat like stall-fed calves. I'm just getting prepared for that. How about you? You know, I'm a man of scripture, of prophecy, and I just, you know, this is my winter coat. It's coming summer. You shall trample the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet. On the day that I do this, listen, the day that Jesus stands for Jerusalem, although all the nations have come to ravish her, all the nations have stood in a degree and in a manner like the Romans or the Chaldeans or anyone else that's designed and thought that they could annihilate the Jews. Jesus will stand and all the nations will fall. Ezekiel chapter 38 and 39 describes a time when in the Jezreel Valley, it'll take 7 years to bury the weapons of warfare that have come against the name of Jesus. 7 years, there will be so much weapons left there by the dead souls, the thought we can take this guy. And I just got to suggest, hey, just think for a moment here. What was it about our God? Think about this. Here's our Father sitting on his throne, just the same way that John describes him, in the midst of a glassy sea. Creatures flying in and out of his presence, and the glory of who he is, causing all humanity to fall on their face, all the angelic host. What was it about the nature of our God that Lucifer looked on and thought, I can take this guy? What was it about Lucifer looking at the throne of God in all of its glory and thought within his heart, I can take this guy? Listen, there are certain portions of the attributes of our God that really we won't understand until we see his throne face to face. There will be a sense of the vulnerability and sweetness and kindness of the Lamb of God in the presence of that throne, and we'll think, maybe this is what Lucifer was thinking. I can take that lamb. But there will be a sense of awe, a such heaven-shuddering glory as Isaiah describes him. The train of his robe fills the temple, and the seraphim and the cherubim flying in and out of his presence, and we will look upon this and there'll be a sense in us that there is such awe and glory that I cannot even look upon it. I've got to fall on my face and just worship him, hoping that I can survive this event. I can survive this event. Jesus says, look, verse 23 of Matthew 24, if anyone says to you, look, here is the Christ, or over there. Where? Over there. A bar. War. Over there. Look, here is Christ, or there. Do not believe it. For many, that's the sense here, plurality of false Christs and false prophets will rise, and they'll show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. See, I have told you beforehand. Listen, I'm old, I realize that, but in my lifetime, I would have never guessed that there would be 3D movies. I mean, better than Godzilla Takes Mothra. Did you see that one in 3D in the early 70s? Yeah. That's a classic. I think it won an Academy Award, I'm not sure. But today, the 3D movies are like, whoa, wow. 3D TVs. Did you know the next 5 years... I said 10 years earlier, but I've been corrected. And in the next 5 years, theaters are going to have not only the 3D experience, but tactile experience as well, along with smell-o-vision. Can you imagine that? Smell-o-vision. So what they're attempting to do is engage you even deeper into the events that are on the movie screen. And that's something, isn't it? I got my own version of smell-o-vision when I watch movies, but... Jesus says, see, I've told you beforehand there's coming a time when sermons, as it were, during the tribulation, will be so powerfully deceptive that even those who know God's word might even possibly be deceived. But what about those who never look at the word of God, who never study God's word, don't have any level of discernment in them because the word of God is living and powerful, says that on this wall, and is changing a person's life? Timothy is told by Paul in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 6 and 7, "For of the sort of those who creep into households and make captives of gullible women, loaded down with sins, led away by various lusts, always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth." I wonder, how is it that in the last days, Paul told Timothy, listen, it's going to be possible for these false prophets and false Christs to gain entrance into homes to lead gullible women into believing the devious, demonic doctrines that the devil is proposing. It would have not been possible without the radio or TV. Would you agree with me? And today, there are all manner of television shows that are just full of nonsense, even theological nonsense. And there's a whole lot of gals that just believe this tripe simply because they haven't spent any time in the Word of God. Paul says it's going to be so. 2 Timothy chapter 4, just a chapter later. "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires. Because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. They will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables." How many of you have heard that the Bible is mythology today? That seems to be the talking point for many atheists and agnostics that are saying, well, you can believe in your mythology and I'll believe in the truth of science, not realizing that in fact the poles are opposite. This is the truth. Well, thank you, iPad. And science is a myth. Oh. What the devil is proposing to gullible ears is that, listen, I'm only going to listen to those that agree with my worldview and philosophy. And that's happening a lot today. Jesus goes on to say in verse 36, "Therefore, if they say to you, look, he's in the desert, don't go out. Look, he's in the inner rooms, don't believe it." Why? Because Jesus says, when I come back, verse 27, look at this. "When I come back, every eye will see me. As the lightning comes from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. From one horizon to the other, all people in that horizon will see the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ." Revelation chapter 1, verse 7 says, "Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him." In other words, those that simply believe that he couldn't possibly be the Messiah. "And all the tribes of the earth will mourn." Why will they mourn? We're going to be excited. Amen? I can't wait for that moment. Why would some people mourn? Because they'll recognize, whoops, I chose the wrong team. I got the tattoo or the implant, ever, whatever it was, to follow this Christ, but he didn't come like this guy. Oops. And that's an eternal oops. Verse 28, "For wherever the carcass is, there the eagles will be gathered together." Immediately after the tribulation, verse 29 through 31, "Of those days the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light and the stars will fall from heaven and the powers of the heavens will be shaken." Imagine that. Suddenly all the stars of the heaven will go. It's like a curtain closing. Clear day, clear night, but the stars disappear. Did you know that our sun is a star? How many of you, that's, what? Really? Yeah. "The sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from heaven, the powers of heaven will be shaken, and the Son of Man will appear in heaven." What's that appearance? A strike of lightning from one end to the other. And every eye will see that it is he. Yes, it's he. Look, he has on the marks of him. Wounds that we would be healed. And he will send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet. And they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. We are going to spend more time concerning verse 31 next Sunday. But I want you to know this. When Jesus comes back, we're not going to have to find him in the desert. We're not going to have to find some secret chamber somewhere. Do you know the handshake?
Oh, I'm not sure.
You got the secret decoder ring?
Well, yeah, maybe.
Every eye will see him. Every eye will either exalt his presence or mourn his return. Question is, who are you this morning? What team have you chosen? If you don't choose Jesus now, there's going to be a disabling, deceptive sermon that the Antichrist is going to preach, and your heart, as Jesus describes, is going to be lent to its lie. Now, I'm not trying to scare you into heaven. Perhaps I'm trying to scare the hell out of you. But you know what? In the end, there's nothing wrong with that either. The bottom line is this. Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Do you know Jesus as your Savior? See, that's the pivotal point, friends. That's all that the Lord is concerned about. And this morning, we're going to be sharing communion. And your kids are going to be returning from Sunday school. And as they do, would you just bow your heads and close your eyes for a moment? I want to give an opportunity to anyone here this morning. Maybe you're a newcomer. Maybe you're here because you lost a bet. I don't know. It's Mother's Day, so you're doing what Mom wants you to do. But would you consider doing what the Holy Spirit wants you to do this morning? Would you consider doing what the Scriptures lead us in recognizing our Jesus as your Savior as well, as the lover of your souls who longs to dance over you even as we sang this morning? Simple prayer invites Jesus into your heart. Here's that prayer, and I'm asking you, if you want to receive Jesus as your Savior, this is a way to do that. Just to pray with me, speak these words. Here's the prayer. Father in heaven, I receive Jesus as my Savior. I beg you, Jesus, wash me in your blood. Cleanse me from my sins. Take away all the record of wrongdoing in my life. I love you, Jesus. Now I know you gave your life for me. Now I know you have always loved me. And you brought me here this morning to open my heart to you. So I receive you now as my Savior. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his Spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.